Today, it's my pleasure to introduce Joe Baldemore. I met Joe 6 months ago while working an Alzheimer's event for the Alzheimer's Association. After a few minutes of chatting with Joe, I knew he could provide so much education to our support group members. I was excited when he accepted our invitation to be our guest speaker today. Joe is currently the program director and one of three research champions for the Alzheimer's Association Southeast Florida chapter. He has an MA in behavioral psychology from Nova Southeastern University, a specialization degree in neuropsychology from Boston College, along with a foundational degree in philosophy and theology from Boston College's School of Theology and Ministry. He is a certified dementia practitioner and instructor. Joe's career with the Alzheimer's Association has been specialized in providing educational programs for the general public and professionals, both online and in person. The educational programs focus on topics such as diagnosis, warning signs, behaviors, communication, living with Alzheimer's disease, and caregiving techniques, as well as awareness campaigns explaining the difference between Alzheimer's and typical aging and the power of early detection. He also facilitates support groups to provide care and support for all those affected by Alzheimer's and other dementias. Joe is personally affected by this disease as his father was diagnosed with Alzheimer's 4 years ago. In addition to all these impressive credentials, Joe brings professionalism, empathy, and a true sense of compassion to what he does. He is the real deal. So get ready to carefully listen to all Joe has to say. Joe, the meeting is now yours.
Yes, thank you so much for that introduction. That's very kind, and thank you so much. So yes, pretty much today what I'd like to talk to you about is about Alzheimer's behavior, what actually starts. Then we're going to talk about particular areas, particular behaviors, things that sometimes we kind of like interchange, but we don't really mean what doesn't really under, you know, the underlying conditions and things like that. Then we'll talk a little bit about new advancement in science and things that we can expect from the future and certain techniques depending on the type of behavior. So, perfect. So this is what we're going to be talking today. Alzheimer's behaviors, what does it start? The one thing, so we are all on the same page, I usually like to start explaining a little bit about this particular area, right? So let me tell you a little bit about dementia and Alzheimer's. So dementia is actually the general term of loss of memory, language, problem solving, and other thinking abilities that are severe enough to interfere with daily life. Or Alzheimer's is the most common cause of dementia. Right? Dementia is not a single disease. It's actually an overall term, like a heart disease. You know, it covers a wide range of specific medical conditions, and this one, including Alzheimer's disease. So the disorders are grouped under this general term that is called dementia. And it's caused by abnormal brain changes. These changes trigger a decline in thinking skills, number one, and also known as cognitive abilities, severe enough to impair daily life as an independent function. And the big part is that they affect the behaviors, feelings, and relationships. And that's what we want to be focusing on. As you might know, Alzheimer's disease accounts for 60 to 80% of cases. Then we have vascular dementia, which occurs because of a microscopic bleeding of blood vessels and therefore the blockage in the brain. And that's the second most common cause of dementia. Those who experience brain changes of multiple types of dementia simultaneously have something that is called mixed dementia. And there are many other conditions that can cause symptoms of dementia, including some of that are reversible, such as thyroid problems and vitamin deficiency. So that's something that I always emphasize. You're having these type of situations to talk to your primary care. And then the sad part is that, you know, often dementia will start slowly and gradually to get worse. Some of you are caregivers, and I, you know, truly understand that you can see those stages in your loved one. So if someone that you know is experiencing any type of difficulties or other changes in thinking skill, never ignore those. Immediately seek help with the doctor, because early prevention and detection is key for future things that we can do. Oops. So this is where Alzheimer's disease starts, right? As far as scientifically, it has not been one fully understanding what causes Alzheimer's disease in most people. The causes, you know, which think, you know, probably includes a combination of all related changes. This is one of the things that, you know, it's the most common part. When we think about these age-related changes, but then there's also parts of that has to do with genetics, the environmental and lifestyle factors. The importance of any of these factors in increasing or decreasing the risk of Alzheimer's disease might differ from person to person. And that's something that we have to always keep in mind. So Alzheimer's disease is a progressive brain disease. It is characterized, okay, keep listening to this, it's very important. The Alzheimer's is characterized by changes in the brain, including amyloid plaques and neurofibrillary or tau tangles. Those are the two big ones. Those two type of proteins, right? So when we think about that, those type of proteins, what they do is that they destroy our brain cells, which are the neurons. And those are the connectors of everything that we process in our brain. So Alzheimer's disease is a condition that destroys the connections between the cells and the brain over time. Eventually, our cells die, and this affects how the brain works as the cells in the brain die and shrinks. So the moral is that usually starts on the frontal lobe, which is part of our intelligence, judgment, and behavior. So those are the things, you know, in the later stages, mid stages, is usually start taking a toll with our language, the way that we talk, right? So that's so far what the evidence and research has been showing. And that's where usually Alzheimer's disease starts, in the entorhinal cortex, which is this yellowish thing that you see here. And then irrigates to the cortical regions, which is all these red things that you see around. So that's just to have an idea of how that starts. So where does Alzheimer's first, you know, affect? What is the area? So the big part is the hippocampus, right? And when we think about the hippocampus, it's an area of the brain that helps form new memories. The damage on the frontal lobe of the brain eventually causes problems with intelligence, judgment, and the big one is behavior. That's what I like. I highlight these parts, you know, which is language, reasoning, and social behavior. As the diseases start taking this course, you know, this damage to the frontal and the temporal lobes affects the not only the memory, but the way that we try to get words out in our language. In healthy people, all sensations like movement, thoughts, memories, feelings are the results of signals that pass through billions of nerve cells or neurons in the brain. So they're constantly communicating to one another through electrical charges that travel down as axons, causing all these releases of chemicals across tiny gaps, neighboring neurons. And when we think about the beta amyloid and the tau proteins, that's are the ones who actually destroy those cells. So therefore, there is no more communication, right? So in a person with Alzheimer's disease, which is again the most basic form of dementia, toxic changes in the brain destroy this healthy balance, right? And the changes may occur, as we have seen through research, years or even decades before the first signs of dementia start showing up. That's why we're so big about keeping in mind those facts, so that way when you start noticing in a loved one or yourself, you know, or anybody, that you start seeing a little changes here and there, so always make sure that, you know, they check with their primary care. So as far as the research, we believe that the process involves the two proteins, the beta amyloids and tau, which somehow become toxic in the brain, because that's what we see when somebody does a PET scan. You can clearly see how they start destroying the cells. So it appears that abnormal tau accumulates, eventually forming these tangles inside the neurons. And the beta amyloid clumps into plaques, which slowly build upon neurons. As the level of amyloid reaches tipping points, there is a rapid spread of tau through the brain. And the reason why I'm talking to you all this is because this is how we're going to explain how behavior starts happening and where exactly. So when beta tau amyloids, right? When we think about that, that might not be the only factor involved in Alzheimer's. You know, there are other changes that affect brain that will play a role over time. And those are vascular system may fail to deliver sufficient blood and nutrients to the brain. The brain might lack the glucose that is needed to power its activity. And then we have the chronic inflammation. Says in the microglial cells fail to clear away debris. And then there is something that is called astrocytes that react to this distressed microglia. So eventually, those healthy neurons lose their ability to communicate. And as neurons die, the brain starts shrinking. Just to give you an idea, a healthy brain is about 3 pounds when we reach adulthood. And it will stay that way. People with Alzheimer's disease, towards the late stage of the disease, the brain can get to weight even a pound. So just to give an idea how that starts shrinking. And it usually starts in the hippocampus, which is the part that the brain uses the most to the learning and memory process. So people might begin to experiencing, as I mentioned before, memory loss, impaired decision-making, language problems, And as the neurons keep trying, that people usually loses the ability to think and make decisions and function independently. So that's just a quick overview of that. So when it comes to the behavior, let's keep in, we're gonna talk about different behaviors. So, you know, there are the neuropsychiatric symptoms in Alzheimer's disease. And then when we start thinking about specific behaviors, right? So Alzheimer's behavior, the chief cause of behavioral symptoms is the progressive deterioration of brain cells. So that's where everything starts. There are other factors, medication, environmental influences, some medical conditions that also can cause or make them worse. Usually in the early stages of the disease, you know, people experience behavior and personality changes. And one of the big ones is being irritable. So when you look at this little picture right here, so, you know, when we look at the mild areas of the behavior, is usually depression, anxiety, irritability, apathy, and disinhibition. When we're talking about the severe symptoms, you know, is we're going through the agitation, aggression, aberrant vocalization, hallucinations, and euphoria. We're gonna touch a little bit on everything that is there. So common personality change, right? Those are things that we also have to keep in mind, because Alzheimer's disease brings very personal changes that can make your loved one hard to recognize. And I have seen that happening. You know, usually the ones very loving and friendly person, well, it suddenly becomes verbally aggressive to their loved ones. They might reject to enjoy things the way they used to do it. They will make impolite comments. And as these changes are happening, the personality also changes. But keep in mind that all this is happening because of the disease, and it will worsen over time as the brain cells continue to die. So going back to the part when we're talking about common personality changes. So Alzheimer's disease usually first strikes the part of our brain that controls our memory, right? It damages the cerebral cortex, which affects our social behavior, the way that we communicate, our language. So that's the essence of our personality, and it comes later in time. So the changes that you might notice in your loved one when we're talking about personality changes is loss of interest in things they used to enjoy. That's a big one. Acting suspicious, confused, or anxious. As you can see, that's part of the mild area. When you start getting aggressive, hitting or angry words easily, being rude and intensive, that's what we consider getting into the severe area of the behavior, right? So sometimes distant, they might be seen distant, distracted, or very passive. It comes the part that, you know, they're seeing or believing things that are not there. So that's what we call hallucinations and sometimes delusion, and we will touch on that. Unusual sexual behaviors. We have seen that in a lot of our patients, and, you know, such as becoming clingy or falling in love with someone else. And those are things that are happening. And then certain stressful situations, some of you might experience that with your loved one, which are changes in schedules. You don't keep the same routine, so the person becomes a little aggravated with stuff. Maybe visiting a new place where you're taking out of the safety of their environment, that might heighten the confusion and fear in a person that has Alzheimer's disease. So there are ways that, you know, you can identify these triggers in advance, and you can plan ahead on how to handle this type of reactions and situations. So very important is just to stay alert of all these kind of situations, whether it's big or small. So, you know, one of the things that I like to talk about, these are like examples of triggering situations, and those can include like a hospital stay, moving it to a new place, getting in contact with new people, maybe, you know, caregivers, turnovers, switch of schedules, and the usual way of doing things. When somebody, you know, sometimes if we request that, you know, they take a bath or change clothes, those things can trigger reactions of the behavior. Believe it or not, like the bathing part is one of the major stumbling blocks, because usually people with Alzheimer's disease will resist help, because even though that the disease is taking a toll, they still think about these type of situations are very intimate. So, you know, some people might have the fear of the water that has been developed, or is it too cold, too hot, too hot, and sometimes also the embarrassment. So it's good to keep those things in mind. So, you know, there isn't a clear cut things that will happen, but it's always good to keep notes on things that you might notice. So that way, if there is anything happening, you can go back and start looking at changes, you know, what can cause this. So just little things that you can do. So talking about behaviors, these are the psychological symptoms, behavioral and psychological symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. So how do we deal with this personality changes? If you look on the spectrum of the changes, right? Agitation, depression, apathy, repetitive questioning, psychosis, aggression, sleep problems, wandering, and variety of inappropriate behaviors. So all these things, when you look at these particular graphics, at the end of the day, the family caregivers is the burden, right? Think about that. So I always say, and you probably have been hearing this 1,000 times, if you don't know how to take care of yourself, you will hardly be able to take care of someone else. So it can be hard to accept the loss of our loved ones' old self, right? But it helps to remind yourself that personality changes stem from brain disease and is not deliberate. So, for example, you know, one of the things that I like to say when you have any of this kind of behavioral and psychological symptoms or reactions from your loved one, is focus on the moment, right? Because when we think about the way that we do things, right? So apathy and lack of drive, there are interrelated in this common type of symptoms of dementia. So the rule of thumb is don't try to reason with the person or push them to do something. Recommendation is instead try to find a way to engage them as they are in the present moment. Simple activities, you know, such as listening to music can help relax the person. Sorting or stacking objects also keeps the mind occupied because it's very repetitive. So the person doesn't have to go out of the way to start thinking logically. simple things like, you know, going for a walk, if the person physically can still do it, maybe a car ride. You know, those are good options to kind of diffuse situations, because the intention is a distraction from the particular moment where the behaviors are showing. So, you know, finding a quiet time and place to talk, feel a safe environment, keeping an eye level, it's very important, and remind them of your name and the relationship to them. So kind of like start juggling that memory as needed to be. And that's, you know, things that are very important. So the other thing that I like to talk about is like these little coping tips that we have, like, you know, personal comfort, checking for pain, hunger, thirst, constipation, all these different things, and avoiding being confrontational. Why? Because when we look at all these different things that are happening, right? Person might be in pain, hunger, thirsty, all these different things. We want to make sure that they are comfortable. So avoiding being confrontational or arguing about facts is very important. For example, if a person expresses a wish to go visit a parent who might have died years ago, don't point out that the parent is dead. Instead, say, your mother is a wonderful person. I would love to see her. So it's like getting into the reality that they are showing. So that way we redirect the person's attention, and, you know, always try to remain flexible, supportive, responding to the emotion, right? Not the behavior. That's very important to keep in mind, because we want to make sure that when we do this, we're actually responding to the actual emotion, not the way that we behave. So creating a calm environment, avoiding noise, glares, insecure spaces, too much background, distractions, sometimes loud TV, things like that, allowing adequate rest between the stimulating events. And so are things, you know, just to keep in mind, acknowledging the requests and respond to them, look for reasons behind each of the single behaviors. Always very important, I'm gonna keep saying this through the presentation, is just make sure that you consult your physician to identify causes that might be relating to medications or illness, and therefore the behavior becomes more intense. Exploring for various solutions. There is no one single formula for everything. These are just ideas and little things that we can do. And don't take the behavior personally. That's very important. And share your experiences with others, like, you know, especially like when you come to these safe environments of having a support group, when you can talk to each other about things that are happening, get, you know, how do you deal with this? What was the worst part? Like things like that, you know, because you can talk to caregivers where their loved ones are at different stages of the disease. And then if you can figure out the causes of the stress, call for support, contact your doctor. You can always call us. We have a dedicated 24/7 helpline. And it's completely free, and you will be talking to a master level clinician. I will be sharing that information later on the presentation. So those are things, you know, when we're talking about the behaviors and the behavioral psychological part. Yes. Oh, I thought somebody was trying to ask a question. So next, you know, when we're talking about a cognitive spectrum of behaviors, right? So we saw the psychological part. This one now is a little bit more into the psychiatric area when we talk about behaviors. You know, we have the normal condition, the mild cognitive impairment, and then Alzheimer's disease. As you can see, the risk, right? we have Alzheimer's disease risk when it comes to the genetic part, and then the psychotic risk genes and genetic risk from other neuropsychiatric disorders. And this is very important to talk about because the cognitive spectrum is due to complex changes, right, that occur in the brain. People with Alzheimer's disease may see or hear things that they don't have basis in reality, and that's very important to understand. So the hallucinations involve the hearing, seeing, smelling, or feeling things that are not really there. Believe it or not, seeing and smelling and even feeling things that are not even there. So it's very important to keep that in mind. So for example, you know, someone with Alzheimer's disease may see children playing in the living room when there is no one, and they can actually hear it, see it, feel it, and smell it. So that's the part. So delusions, which is the other part of the psychosis, are false beliefs that the person thinks that are real. So just to give you an example, the person might think that her spouse is in love with someone else. I'm not sure, but you know, like I have seen it sometimes on my father, the way that he reacts. When my mother pick up the phones, he immediately start thinking, she's talking to, like, you know, he make this irrational thought. For us, that we're living in our reality, but in his reality, something else is happening. So, you know, we try to diffuse the situation. And that's part also of the paranoia, which is another type of delusion in which the person may believe without any good reason that others are mean, lying, unfair. They're out to get me. They become, you know, that's why the person with Alzheimer's disease become very suspicious and fearful of and jealous of people. I have seen cases where people with the disease are actually accusing their loved ones or trying to poison them and stealing from them and things like that. And it's just part of the paranoia. As I say, you know, it's just all these things that are happening because of the disease. It's not because the person really mean it. It's just, you know, things. So again, you know, when hallucinations and other problems might be related to medications. And that's why you have to have that conversation with a team of doctors to make sure that everybody's on the same page. And if you see these type of problems, you know, just make sure that you stay on top of that. And like I keep mentioning, you know, try to stay calm, don't argue or blame your loved ones for these situations. Instead, you know, be gentle and let them know that they're in a safe area and there is no need to worry without going into much details. Just try to kind of like go back, but, you know, going back to this, when it comes to neuropsychiatric symptoms like agitation and affective symptoms, you know, that's just a comorbid neuropsychiatric syndromes. And we usually see that on the stages of mild cognitive impairment, which is early stages of Alzheimer's disease, going into the mid stage. So that's why it's important to keep notes and everything that you see. And we were talking earlier before everybody joined us about all these new approaches that we are trying to develop as far as symptom assessments and treatments. And that's something that we are trying to continuously developing. So as we always say, somewhere right now, and somewhere in the world, someone is actually looking for that cure of the disease. So when it comes to, you know, looking forward to the future, this is what we want to see as far as, you know, the research part. So we want to find some sort of therapy or medication that actually reduce or clear the increase of tau and amyloid proteins in the brain. That will be fantastic. Lifestyle interventions, behavioral approaches, all these different, you know, therapies and targeting, so biomarkers through brain imaging, biofluids, emerging markers. On top of this graphic, I just want to show you the way that usually, you know, we are trying to look for this type of research to find a cure. So achieving a deeper understanding of the molecular and cellular mechanisms and how they interact with each other is vital to the development of these new therapies. So I would say in the past 10 years, there has been a lot of progress that have been made to identifying various factors and underlying factors, right? So if you look back in time, about 10 years ago, the only way to possibly diagnose the disease, specifically Alzheimer's disease, was through an autopsy. Now, because of the changes in medical technology, you know, has been great that we can see this. So as far as the process, advances in brain images, right, allows to see the curves of the plaques and tangles living in the brain. Blood and fluid biomarkers are providing insights about when the disease starts and the progress. And those are things that are being continuously studied. And there is also, we're learning more about the genetic underpinnings of the disease and how they can actually affect particular biological pathways. So these advances enables the development of testing, promising new therapies. You know, when you look at it, this include drugs that reduce or clear the increases of tau and amyloid proteins. That's the one that we're aiming for. Therapies that target vascular system, glucose metabolisms, inflammations, the lifestyle interventions again. And the one thing when we're talking about lifestyle interventions, we always talk about these four motivable factors that are so important, which is physical exercise, diet and nutrition, cognitive training, and then the big one is socialize, right? So those are things that we can do at any time in life. And research has shown, before we used to say, you know, they may be, now we are 100% certain that we can say, yes, this will allow in kind of like the prevention of developing cognitive decline, which can lead to any type of dementia. And then we're trying to focus also on behavioral approaches like social engagement that will enhance brain health. And one of the reasons what we start gearing towards that is because during COVID, we saw a big increase on dementia cases, and it was mostly because of isolation. So, you know, research is always moving quicker and closer. And I hope that in my lifetime, we can actually see some sort of medication that can delay or prevent the devastation of dementia. Really quick, you know, this is just a new phase on the treatment. So if we look at these two promising therapies, they target amyloid, and that's what we, you know, try and see. So the later one, lecanemab, has been shown that in people with mild cognitive impairment has shown tremendous results as far as the therapy. So these are things, you know, to keep in mind when you're looking at the research and how things are going. So today there is over 140 unique therapies that are being tested. And what we're looking is for the aspects of the biology of the disease, right? So as you can see, this is what we're trying to target in the brain. So this part right here is a healthy brain. This is a brain with Alzheimer's disease. So what we're looking for is, you know, the vascular stressors, neuroinflammation, the big ones, which are the amyloid beta and the tau, the cellular communication. So all these different things that are happening in our brain, that's the biology of, and that's what we're trying to treat. So right now, these two medications, as I say, you know, has shown improvement for people that are on the early stages of mild cognitive impairment. Unfortunately, when someone already develops Alzheimer's disease, there is nothing that we can still use to kind of like slow it down or do things like that. So it's important, you know, that we always keep looking for these different type of resources to keep up with the studies that are happening, because it's very important. It's very important to, you know, be on the know about all these different things that are happening that sometimes, you know, we don't think about. This is our research resources. You know, you can always go to our website. We have tremendous information about anything that you can think of when it comes to research. Trial match is one of the biggest things that, you know, you can look for actual research trials that are happening within your area. And sometimes what I like to point out is that you don't necessarily have to have Alzheimer's disease or dementias to get into a clinical trial. And sometimes clinical trials doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to be taking a medication. Sometimes these clinical trials, they just want to look at your cognitive understanding, and they take information, you know, regarding your age, any type of underlying conditions, health history, things like that. And sometimes these type of trials, they will send you a tablet home and they will ask you to go at least 2 hours every other day and do these different type of games and things like that. And they're just measuring cognitively how alert you are, if there is any signs of decline, things like that. So, you know, it's always interesting. And that number that you see there, our helpline, is the one that I was telling you, that keep that number handy. You can call us 24/7, ask any type of questions, doesn't necessarily have to be related to Alzheimer's, you know, might be experiencing some other stuff. Maybe when your loved one is becoming agitated and you don't really know what to do, please call us, because we have master level clinicians that will be able to talk to you at any time and guide you, provide you some resources, provide you some techniques to do different things. And you know, it's important to have this information and these references, not only if you're going through the situation right now, but, you know, things that you can share with other people, make them aware that these are resources that are available. And that, you know, just take me to the final two slides, so hopefully nobody's falling asleep. So, you know, our mission is to eliminate Alzheimer's disease through the advancements of research, provide enhanced care support to all affected, and to the reduce risk of dementia through the promotion of brain health. Very important. And I'll talk, you know, when we do questions. And our vision is a world without Alzheimer's disease and all other dementias.